Commission, Srimati Ramani Vijayaraghavan, Srimati Lakshmi Menon, and Srimati Shobhana Bala.
Thank you. We start today. We have an invocation by Srimati Lakshmi, and once again, respecting tradition, I request everyone to remain seated.
Shama Tallini radharan neeve jayasite nirvahyup vashama talli paramugame namma paradhina patitana pai paramuka mele maranajita mandagamani maranajita mandagamani mahadeva mahita priyavarani maranajita mandagamani mahadeva mahita priyavarani niramaye niradashyamale niramaye niradashyamale niramaye niradashyamale niramaye niradashyamale nityakalyana gunalaye niramaye niradashyamale nityakalyana gunalaye ambapara kamelanamma paradhina patitana pai paramuka mela
Thank you, Lakshmi. We start today's proceedings by honoring and hearing our two guests of honor. Shri Lalit Man Singh needs no introduction. He was the former secretary, foreign secretary of the government of India, and also the former director general of the ICCR, a man of letters, a connoisseur of art and music. I'm sure many of us remember the lovely speech he delivered on the occasion of our beloved Palghat Raghu Mama's 84th birthday celebrations. Welcome, welcome to Chennai, sir. To honor him, I request Shri R. Krishnaswamy, Managing Committee Member and the Secretary of the Narada Gana Sabha, to do the honors. Thank you, Shri Krishnaswamy. And Shri Lalit Man Singh ji, could we hear you once again?
Vidwans and Rasikas of this great city, what a joy it is to be back here. If you think of Delhi now, cold, foggy, inhospitable, and the fog is not just ecological, it is also political and much more. So it's good to escape Delhi and come here and breathe the fresh air, get the oxygen of culture, which is why I think you are the luckiest people in the world. Before I pay tribute to the great GNB today, Let me say a word of appreciation for the remarkable group of people who have been behind this event. Many of them are sitting right here in front of you. These are people who have volunteered a part of their life to remind us of the great people who were not political leaders, who were not great industrialists, who were not great generals, but they were people who actually defined who we are as a nation. And if India is today regarded not just another country, but a great civilization, we need to be reminded from time to time of these great figures of our history. So I remember with great nostalgia an event which took place like this about 2 years ago when you were all honoring Palghat Raghu. And I think it was very poignant that that was perhaps his last public appearance here. So I want to pay a tribute to these people. I don't want to name them, there are so many of them who have been working behind the scenes, but let me say how grateful I am that you are doing this selfless task. I am not going to speak or give an assessment of GNB. I think that would be very impertinent. You have so many Vidwans here, so many people who have known him, have followed his career, who are actually doing that. And when I saw this brilliant documentary on his life, I thought nothing more needs to be said about GNB. You just have to listen to him and imagine that great man's musical genius. I was struck by the fact that GNB was studying English honors at the Madras Christian College. And surely as a student of literature, he must have come across Shakespeare's popular line in Twelfth Night when he said, "If music be the food of love, play on." I'm sure it would have occurred to GNB that Shakespeare for once was not adequate, that music is not just the food of love. Music is actually the diet of divinity. And therefore, music was a great spiritual force, which I'm glad led GNB towards music rather than the other profession that his father wanted him to be in, that is to become a lawyer. And I mean no disrespect to the lawyers here, particularly Mr. Vijay Raghavan. But I think GNB made the right choice. So, I, as a Rasika standing before you, I take pride in the fact that listening to the greatest musician of our times has been a defining fact of my life. It has added value to my life. It has given meaning to my life. And therefore, when I think that I have lived in the times when I have heard these great people live before me, I think that itself is for me a celebration of my life. I am familiar more with Hindustani musicians because I grew up in the north. But even so, I feel my life has been sanctified by some of the greatest names of the South. I have listened with great admiration, great devotion to all-time greats like Semangudi and M.S. Subbalakshmi. I have heard that galaxy of Veena players like Veena Balachandran, M.N. Shankar Shastri, M. Doraiswamy Iyengar and others. I've heard Mahalingam, the great flutist. All these people are no more. But remember that they were people who lived in our times, and we must be proud that we lived in the times of these people. And fortunately, there are still many immortals were still with us. And I consider myself fortunate to have been able to sit in front of them and listen to their great music. I'm a great admirer of somebody who is sitting right here in front of me, Professor T.N. Krishnan. I have heard Lalgudi Jayaraman. I have heard M.N. Ramani. I have heard Umayurupuram Sivaraman and many others who are still amongst us. I have heard Dr. Balamurali Krishna. I have heard him sing. I am told he is a good violinist too, but I never heard him on the violin. These are the great memories of my life. But this brings me to an issue I want to share with you this evening. And the issue is something that struck me when we were together for celebrating Palghat Raghu's life. At that time, I said what a great idea it was to have all the great musicians of the South coming together to honor a fellow great musician. This is the kind of thing that never happens where I live in the North, particularly in Delhi. And I did make the remark that many of the very well-known names in music spend more of the time on the cocktail circuit cultivating the VIPs than in practicing their music. So I am a great admirer of the traditions that you have still maintained in the South. Now, many of you will remember that there was an unusual picture there of T.N. Krishnan and Lalgudi Jayaraman sitting next to each other, even speaking to each other. I think that's a picture that many will remember throughout their life. But today I want to register a complaint. The complaint is that while dancers from the South are frequently seen on the stages of the North, particularly in Delhi, why is it that musicians from the South are rarely ever heard in the North and particularly in Delhi? And I was struck by the fact that today when I arrived this afternoon from Delhi, I opened the pages of the Hindu to find out how they had reported yesterday's great function. And I was struck by the fact that whoever the reporter was described, I think rightly, that this was a celebration of the life of one of the greatest Carnatic musicians who was born a century ago. And I asked myself, is it right to describe him as one of the greatest Carnatic musicians? Well, what's wrong with that, you'll ask. But I think what he should be described as, rightly, is one of the greatest Indian musicians and not just a Carnatic musician. So, what is it that makes a great musician of the North an Indian musician and a great musician of the South described as a Carnatic musician? There is therefore a dividing line, a glass wall, a Berlin wall, call it the line of the Vindhyas which divides the North from the South. But I think it's unfair that Carnatic music is still regarded as a regional music. Music in the North is regarded as Indian music. And I think an effort has to be made to remove that distinction. I've often wondered why this kind of apartheid has taken place, why these double standards have been applied to two great systems of music which are actually part of the same family. Maybe it is the tradition of the South, the culture of humility, of not being too prominent and so on. Maybe North Indian ears are not sensitive to the delicacies of Carnatic music. Maybe Carnatic musicians don't feel at home in the North. Maybe they miss what they get in the South. Maybe the idlis, the dosas, the vada padams are not as good in Delhi as they are in here. Maybe Delhi is too cold in winter and too hot in summer. I know it for a fact that Professor Krishnan migrated from Delhi because you couldn't stand the cold of Delhi. So whatever be the reason, I think the time has come when all of us must make an effort to bring Carnatic music into the mainstream of Indian music. It's not as if efforts have not been made in the past to bring down these artificial barriers. Let me refer to the 18th century, to the great trinity of Shyamasastri, Tyagaraja and Muthuswami Dikshitar. Remember, the third of this trinity, Muthuswami Dikshitar, was taken by his yoga guru, Chitamparanatha, to Varanasi, where he spent 6 years studying Sanskrit, studying yoga, and listening to the music of the north. Another great musical genius of the 18th century, the contemporary of the Trinity, Maharaja Swati Tirunal, himself was a great connoisseur of North Indian music. He not only knew Sanskrit, he wrote poetry in Hindi. He has composed music for Drupad, Khayal and Tumris. So these efforts have been done sporadically to bring down these barriers, but they haven't actually succeeded. And let us look at the life of GNB himself. The fact that he was a great and unabashed admirer of the great Bade Ghulam Ali Khan Saab. In fact, I believe what I have read is that a lot of the Carnatic Vidwans were upset at the fact that he fell at the feet of Bade Ghulam Ali Khan Saab. But the point is, GNB never regarded himself as somebody who was bound so rigidly by the traditions of Carnatic music that he could not reach out to other forms of music. In fact, I distinctly remember that GNB had advised people, advised Carnatic musicians to study the Drupad and get the Drupad style of singing into Carnatic music. And equally, he had advised North Indian musicians to pay serious attention to the Kalpita or Kalpana style of music in the South. So, in my own modest way, I have done my bit for bringing the North and South together to expose the great art of the South to the ignorant North and to the rest of the world. I take pride in the fact that when I was Director General of the ICCR, the largest number of artists and certainly the largest number of Carnatic musicians ever sent abroad by the Government of India was during those 3 years. And let me recall an incident which I think fulfilled the task that I was thinking I was doing. I was going all over the country to find out the great talent that was there and to project them abroad as the pride of India. And in the course of this journey, I landed in Bangalore. I had heard about Doraiswamy Iyengar as a great Veena player. And so I went to his house. He was a bit surprised to see me. He didn't know what the ICCR was. He didn't know what a director general was. So anyway, I then broached this subject. I said, I would like you to perform for the Festival of India in the Soviet Union. And he immediately said, no, I don't feel happy going outside. I don't travel very much. I don't feel comfortable. I don't know if they will understand my music abroad. But finally, at the end of it, I persuaded him to accept our request to perform, not just for the festival, but one of the major openings of the Festival of India. And there I was in the Great Hall of the Kremlin, where Doraiswamy Iyengar was heading the Panchaveena recital. And at the end of it, the entire crowd was on its feet applauding. And the applause lasted for nearly 10 minutes. And I could see Doraiswamy Iyengar, I could see his face looking very bewildered at the fact that all these strange people who he thought couldn't understand his music had actually appreciated and it had gone straight to their heart. So, let me end this with this plea to all of you that this glass wall must be broken that the north and the south must be brought together. If from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, India is one nation, then certainly Indian music is one music. It is not Hindustani, it is not Carnatic, it is not Odissi, it is not Manipuri, it is Indian music. Now, I'm glad that this was a thought that must have struck the organizers. I see in the program that there is a jugalbandi between Dr. Ramani and Pandit Hariprasad Chaurasia. That's a brilliant idea. But the point is, it should not be confined between musicians. It has to be extended between the vidwans of the both schools of music. It has to be extended to the rasikas on both sides, and then only we can say that we have achieved our aims. Now, is this too much of a challenge? I don't know. I have seen people in the south do things which I thought were impossible, like the kind of event they organized for Palghat Raghu. And so I think this is a challenge which I will pose to the organizers. Can you achieve this? If I look at the people who have been behind these great events, people like Mr. Vijay Raghavan, Lakshmi Menon, Mr. Krishnamurti, Mr. Krishnaswamy, and others who are here, I am absolutely confident that this is a job that can be achieved. And if I may borrow a phrase from somebody who is well known to you, yes, we can. Thank you.
Thank you, Mansingh ji, once again, for sharing with us certain interesting facts and for accepting our invitation and being here today. Our next guest of honor needs no introduction. He is Sri Rajiv Menon. Even though his foray into filmdom is in the role of a filmmaker and a cinematographer, I'm sure you'll agree with me that with the kind of looks he's been endowed, he could compete with any of the actors of Tinseldom today. I would also like to tell you that he hails from a family of musicians and he has a very keen ear for music. And his father was well known to the musical genius that was GNB. Before he speaks to us, I request Sri Vijay Raghavan, Managing Committee member and advocate, to honor him. Thank you. Rajiv, please address the crowd.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Lalit Mansingh ji, the organizing committee of the GNB Fest, T.N. Krishnan sir, Dhananjayan sir, and so many great rasikas of Carnatic music here. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. When my father was a naval officer, we lived in various naval colonies and we didn't have the privilege of listening to radio, or because in Vizag or in Delhi, and it was music which was being played at home every day at 6:30. My mother sang. And when the lady sang the invocation and she sang the song in Kannada, it got goosebumps to me. She sang it very well, but that was the song that my mother used to sing every time at Navratri at our house. Kannada by a GNB composition. As I think she mentioned that my father knew GNB, I must recount, it was actually like a threshold guardian. My father was the ADC to the governor, and GNB was traveling on the same flight as the governor, and GNB was carrying his tampura with him. So the tampura, he brought it into the cabin, and it was, he was holding onto it, and it was sticking straight close to the governor's face. So my father as ADC didn't know now what to do. Why is this man pushing? If there was clear air turbulence, it would probably have gone into his face. So he censured this gentleman and said, why don't you keep it separately and sit, you know, in another row? To which Mr. GNB moved further, and then he asked, who's this gentleman? Then he found out he was Mr. GNB. And when he came back home and told my mother that I met Mr. GNB on the flight and he had this big tampura which is going to go into the... he said, he's the greatest singer and I would love to learn from him. So my father did a bold face and went and started trying to meet GNB and tell him that, listen, my wife is a great fan and she wants to learn from you. So it was a very strange way of meeting, but my mother did go and meet, but he came back to Chennai and promised that he would be coming back to Trivandrum, but he didn't, and it was unfortunate that he passed away young. When we came to Chennai and we started listening to Carnatic music more regularly, it became a great joy, you know. I mean, kacheri is all around. The great privilege of being in Chennai. And that was also the time that Doordarshan used to air these old films. And my first impression of GNB was this Kamboji Viruttam of Yenai Maravene. It is the best Kamboji I have ever heard, and it irritates me no end that today some singers sing and you can't figure out whether you're starting with Shankaravarnam or Hari Kamboji and then going to sing. You cannot get a better Kamboji in 2 minutes. Now, how did this man do it? He was a genius. Everybody knows it. Everybody in this audience knows. His Ragam Tanam Pallavis were famous. A man known for, you know, singing 40 minutes of Kamboji was called on to stage. He had to act. And what is very interesting in that piece is if you notice, there are two sections in that Kamboji piece. One ends with him giving his big flourish up and down, and you can hear a clarinet doing the same thing in the background. Now, this was recorded live, I guess, and he was painting also, and he has no expression. You have to see the thing, and he's absolutely singing it in such a perfect manner, and he's acting, and he's frozen there. A man who sings 40 minutes is being told, listen, finish this in 2 minutes. So it's like taking the greatest test player and asking him to play T20. And what he did was to do it in absolute style. So this is my first impression of GNB sir. And then I come and we move to a flat. And then we slowly get indoctrinated in a different manner. It was what I call indoctrination from the stairs above. First, when we lived in Teenmurthy apartments, I had a great Rasika staying on top of me, and we call him Ramesh Mama. He was a chartered accountant, but he too belonged to the religion where God was GNB. And you know, it was interesting that in the morning he would play a ragam and you could hear it from my mother's bedroom, and when we had a bath, you could hear him memorizing every mriga through the bathroom. So I heard the ragam twice, once original and then second. And during this period, I was getting more and more indoctrinated and falling as a fan to M.D. Ramanathan. So here are the two poles apart. One, a fan of M.D.R. and one who's a fan of GNB. And we would meet and he would tell me that, what did you play today? I would ask him. Then he would say, this is Ragam Tanam Pallavi of Todi in Perambur. And he would tell it. So the next would be, this is Natakurunji at so-and-so place. So you started recognizing which recording is from where, who is it, Murugu Bhupati is playing, somebody else is playing. So slowly the thing started expanding. And what is very important for an artist who comes up sometime like this and makes a seismic shift in the way the music is presented, I think what one saw in GNB is not, they were great musicians. Is he the greatest? Is he the true star? I think when we look back and say he came at a time when music was changing, when music was a paid performance, and when people came, ordinary people came to large numbers to the theater, it became necessary that it wasn't just a recording. What you came to was to see a star perform. GNB was the first star of Carnatic music. It wasn't just a raga coming through. It had a certain style to it. There was nothing, you know, functional about his music. And the depth that he brought, I mean, it rings in my ear even now, because I have probably listened to that Rangam Tayanam Pallavi of Shahana, and I keep comparing the phraseology. And that was a Chauka Kala presentation of him, which is rare, but it completely brought out that ragam in such a measure, because I always used to listen to Giripai and then listen to this. So it's a comparison between MDR and this. And it is remarkable that this man could sing in so many different styles. What was very interesting is, when you look at Carnatic music, the joy of Carnatic music in a kacheri is to hear a Bhairavi, a Kalyani, a Todi, the big Carnatic ragas that, you know, satisfy you. And sometimes people sing 40 minutes, but the jaan of the raga, that whole thing doesn't come in. But GNB's each and every mriga, if you were to stretch it up, slow it down, you would see a great construction in it. And then this man had the skill of constructing something and compressing it in time. It was almost like making an ad film of a sangati. It would just put so much together that even now when you listen to it, you have to listen very carefully. You cannot listen casually to a GNB concert, because you have to know what he's doing. In this documentary, which they said, they had a Ragam Tanam Pallavi in Todi. In there, each landing note that he lands is so beautiful, the proportion is so beautiful, that you wonder, did anybody sing like this? You know, how did this man get it? So a star who got audiences and who bought a new style of singing, but his contribution to other lesser known rags and making them major, like, who can forget the Deva Manohari Ragam Tanam Pallavi, or his rendition of Malavi? Now, these were a person who was a pure classicalist at one stage, as well as taking on lesser known rags and expanding on it, contributing to the already large Carnatic catalog and, you know, bringing it into concert stage. Then comes the great contribution of him as a Vaigyakara, as a great composer. So when you look at his compositions and his singing style and his contribution to pure classical ragas as well as the modern ones, you often feel that this was a complete musician who changed the way kacheris were performed. And I would call it like, there are certain movements in an art form and a certain movements in a form that shifts, and the form shifts to a higher gear. And one of it was, if you study the way Indian cricket was played, there were great players. But I think one of the most important innings we have seen is VVS Lakshman scoring 281 at second innings. We suddenly believed we could always win. But what was important is the style with which it was done. Indians love style. We don't like things to become boring. And I think GNB was one of the greatest stylists. And he revitalized the entire Carnatic music repertoire and re-energized the kacheri format. And more importantly, if there was a temple for Carnatic music, one of the main gopurams under which I'm sure the presiding deity would be GNB. And if there would be that temple, I'm sure the pujari and the man who would do the puja every day would be Sri Murali Vijay Raghavan, my dear friend. So for all of us bhaktas of Carnatic music and rasikas, it is important that events like this happen, because I must confess that of late some of the kacheris have become like rock concerts, where there is a need to get applause after every song. And sometimes you wonder, where is this depth we are talking about? You know, where is this difference between film music and... And there was a beautiful point that Mansingh ji mentioned about North India not accepting Carnatic music as much as we accept Hindustani music. And this is a fact, what he said. But I think the only way you can bridge that gap is what in some ways has been done by A.R. Rahman. Now what A.R. Rahman did, I mean, there have been great music directors before him, great tunesmiths. I don't think anybody tuned Carnatic music rags better than M.S. Vishwanathan did. I don't think anybody combined Carnatic music with Western classical music better than, say, Ilaiyaraaja did. But what made Rahman work in the North is he composed in Hindustani rags. It is difficult for them to comprehend the complexity of Kamboji. Now, there's no point feeling superior. The fact is, we cannot understand opera. We feel it's something going like that, but we don't know. The more we know, the deeper is the joy. Aramai Yarangirnal Dan. You have to be an arwar in our love for Carnatic music to appreciate it more. The more you listen, the more joy you get. But there is a distinct difference between the greats like Semaguri Mama and GNB sir and MDR, that you listen to it again and again, there is something new that keeps sparkling. And it's important for rasikas like this to pause. While we laud the present, it's also important for us in terms of history to remember one of the greatest stars who revitalized and stylized in Carnatic music to suit the present audience. And I think it's a privilege, and may the temple grow, may the bhaktas grow, and may we all have and may it survive in the cyberspace for so many people to listen to the greatness of GNB and flourish. Thank you so much.
Thank you for that lovely speech, Rajiv. And thank you for detailing the legendary GNB, his music and his contributions. And I'm very sure that the religious following that is of GNB is growing, and it will continue to grow. And you're very right, Vijay Raghavan, the torchbearer, has passed it on well lit, so much so that we have the greatest Rasika in his son, Vishnu, who's hardly 22. And I would thank all of you on the dais for being such a lovely group here today, and we look forward to the mellifluous voice of Sudha Raghunathan. Thank you. I call upon Sri Rajiv Menon to honor Padma Shri Sudha Raghunathan. And also honor her fellow artist, Sri B. Raghavendra Rao on the violin. Sri Neyveli Skanda Subramanyam on the mridangam. And Sri R. Raman on the morsing. Thank you, Rajiv.
Sadhana, Namaskaram to every one of you present at this august gathering. I say a very, very special namaskaram to Sri Mansingh ji, to the dignitaries present here, to Rajiv Menon ji, who was also the speaker. How can I explain the emotions that play around in my heart today, this evening, as I sing before you? Is it happiness? Is it just joy? Is it pride? Is it honor? Is it like singing for a function in the family? If I might say truthfully, it is an amalgam of all these thoughts put together. To be able to be given the good fortune, or to have this stage to be able to present our music today to who I can claim as my dear, respected, honorable grand guru, the legend Sri G.N. Balasubramanian. I'm sure all of you can feel the pulse of emotions that I have just expressed now. If you were in my place, I'm sure you would also voice the same thought process. There's so much to reflect about Sri GNB, so much in his music to bring out, so many dimensions, yet time is so little for us, and we here on the dais will certainly try to do our little best, our best to project, to give you a small view of how much this legend has done in his span of 55 years as a composer, as a musician who gave life to so many kritis, to so many rare kritis, who set to notation so many unheard of kritis then of Saint Tyagaraja. So we try and put all of this together and present to you, dear Guru, dear Grand Guru, a Samarpanam to Sri GNB. We began with one of his own favorite Varnams that he used to sing, a Varnam of Sri Pattanam Subramanya Iyer in Abhogi Ragam. We'll also try to present some of his compositions intertwined between those of Tyagaraja and others. What we will now sing is Varavalla Bhramana in Hamsadva, a composition of Sri GNB.
Varavallabharamana Vignaharana Varavallabharamana Vignaharana Varavallabharamana Vignaharana Varavallabharamana Vignaharana Sarasi Moha Charana Yeah. ಧೃತ ಕಮಲ ಗತಾರಿ ದನುಗೆರಾ